For those of you who do not know, I am Mark Gammon, professor of religion here at Simpson College. I'm on sabbatical, so I've been hiding from most of you. The other night, Sunday night, I was at a concert at Boyd Sherman, Jason Isbell, if anybody knows who that is. And between songs, between songs, he chastised some people and reminded me of something very important I need to say tonight. Please turn off your cell phones. Before we go any further, just make sure that they are on silent or off for the duration of this time. Thank you. I do also want to say that we will have time at the end of the lecture for some questions, and then Dr. Pesci will be doing a very short book signing of his most recent work. So you're welcome to come through, buy a book, talk to him a little bit there too. Emeritus professors Bruce Haddix and Roger Bettsworth established the Matthew Simpson Lecture in Religion 36 years ago. And since that time, Simpson has welcomed some of the most important thinkers in theology and religious studies. They are listed on your program. For those of you who don't know, that's kind of a lineup of rock stars, at least in theology and religious studies. And we can certainly say that tonight's speaker is another very important voice. A little more than 20 years ago, I was browsing the bookstore at Duke Divinity School when I came across a book called The Righteous Gentiles of the Holocaust. This was the first extensive study I had seen about the tragically small number of non-Jews who put their lives at risk to try to save the lives of Jews during the Holocaust. And it was honest and frank about the role that religion played or did not play in those in their actions. I bought the book, I read it, and I thought, wow, this guy's really on to something. And then I put it down and moved on to other things. But what David Besche said in that book actually really stuck with me and kept popping into my head as I pursued my own studies. And it proved to be the jumping off point for my own dissertation years down the road. It's always disappointing to meet people whose work you admire and they turn out to be jerks. Well, a few years later, I got to meet David in person at a seminar at the Holocaust Museum in Washington, D.C. And I was pleased to discover that he was the kind, thoughtful person that I hoped he would be. Now, David's become much more than a Holocaust scholar. In recent years, he's been a leading voice in American evangelical Christianity, a public intellectual whose work has proven hugely influential and controversial in the evangelical community. He writes an award-winning column for Religion News Service, and his 2014 book, Changing Our Mind, prompted renewed discussion about LGBTQ acceptance in the evangelical tradition. He is so well-regarded that somehow he has managed to become the president-elect of the Society of Christian Ethics, which is the leading professional association for Christian ethics, and the future president of the American Academy of Religion, the leading professional association for the study of religion as a whole. That teaching at Mercer, and he told me earlier that he's now also the interim pastor at First Baptist Church of Decatur in Georgia. That suggests to me that there are not enough hours in the day to be David Gushy. Thankfully, he made the time and accepted our invitation to come speak in Indianola tonight, and it is my great pleasure to introduce one of the most important voices in public theology today, Dr. David Gushy.
Well, good evening, Simpson College. Thank you for having me. Thank you for coming out tonight. I understand a tornado may come and we'll all be in it together. I am indeed grateful for this invitation to come to Simpson College to get to meet students and faculty and staff and to join the distinguished roster of lecturers for the Matthew Simpson Lectures. It is an honor. And I am grateful to Dr. Mark Gammon for his special role in making all of these arrangements happen, including on his sabbatical, which you're not supposed to do. So here he is. So thank you, Mark. It's good to meet your president today and so many others, and good to hear the good things that are happening here. So my talk, as has been well advertised on this campus, is called Election 2016, What in God's Name is Going On? And I hope to shed some light on that question in the course of this evening. We do gather, as you may know, on the eve of a presidential election. I understand it's hard to miss it in Iowa. You follow the political ads pretty much every day. Much of my own work has been on the intersection of faith and politics, especially puzzling over the outsized role that evangelical Christians have played in U.S. politics since the 1970s and the peculiar role that they have played. I've written election year books in 2000, 2008, 2012, and now 2016, each one a little bit different, each one about a little bit different moment. The new one is called Letter to My Anxious Christian Friends, and I called it that because I know a lot of anxious Christians and a lot of concerned folks in general related to where we are in our public life right now. I will center my reflections this evening on the especially odd intersection of religion and the 2016 presidential election. My title is a bit edgy. It might sound like I'm taking God's name in vain, but I'm not, because a lot of people are asking God, what is going on right now? There is a lot of anxiety about how this election year has gone. It has indeed been an extraordinary year, and it is not over yet. Today, I just want to step back a bit, to zoom out, try to take a 30,000-foot view of what is going on in this election cycle. In particular, trying to place this election's happenings in the context of recent decades, both in its continuities and discontinuities, and to think especially about where we are now in the ongoing saga of how religion and politics intersect in this still very religious nation. So the first movement of this talk is called The Old Script, Christian GOP Right versus Secular Liberal Democratic Left. Going into this campaign, there was an expected script that had been in place since at least 1980. On the Republican side, it looks something like this. White evangelical Christians, representing about 25% of the U.S. electorate, vastly more than that of the GOP primary voters, especially in states like Iowa and all across the South, would work hard to get a conservative evangelical or a facsimile thereof as the GOP presidential candidate. Or, failing that, they would try to push the whole GOP field in the direction of the Christian Right's priorities, hoping to come up with a candidate who would articulate or actually believe very conservative positions on social issues like abortion and gay marriage, but also hoping for lots of visible talk about God and faith, that a candidate would emerge who would reflect visible religious commitments in his or her policy and other kinds of addresses, and that these would also end up in the platform of the Republican Party. This strategy has been in place ever since the marriage engineered in the late 1970s between GOP operatives and Christian Right preachers like Jerry Falwell. The GOP operatives promised access to GOP candidates and a role in shaping their agenda and rhetoric. The preachers promised to deliver the vast white evangelical voting bloc. Both sides have delivered on their promises, at least in part, though it has always looked to me like the preachers were better at delivering their voting bloc than the operatives were at delivering the kinds of candidates, judges, and policy results that they promised evangelicals every 4 years. Still, it was about as reliable a thing as one had in American politics. Republican primaries would be dominated by the concerns of conservative white evangelicals, and in the end, they would vote Republican at a staggering 75-80%. No matter who the candidate was, George W. Bush, John McCain, Mitt Romney, or anybody blessed by the GOP. By now, we thought the relationship was symbiotic. The Republican Party needed all those white conservative Christians if they wanted to have any hope of winning the national presidential election. And the white conservative Christians needed the Republican Party if they had any hope of advancing their moral agenda in an increasingly multicultural, secular, and pluralistic country. On the Democratic side, there's also been a script. As the Republican Party has grown more dependent on white voters and especially white evangelicals, the Democrats have gone in the other direction. The Democratic Party, over the same period since 1980, has become the party of non-white, secular, and non-Christian America, while also retaining substantial minorities among white Catholics and white mainline Protestants, and a much smaller minority among white evangelicals. Democrats' social agenda tends to be the inverse of the Republican social agenda, where the Republicans are conservative, the Democrats are liberal, predictably, on all kinds of issues. And just as there are Republicans who don't love the whole conservative social agenda of their party under the influence of the Christian right, there are Democrats who don't love the total down-the-line liberal agenda. This binary is like a poorly fitting suit of clothes to a surprising number of people. Abortion makes for a very good example. Many people who vote Democrat are actually pro-life, or at least more nuanced in their opinion about abortion than the absolutist pro-choice orthodoxy of the Democratic Party. But still, the overall pattern holds. We are a left-right, Democrat-Republican, liberal-conservative, divided reality, if that's how it has been. An aspect of the Democratic ethos has been that their use of religious talk is much, much more muted if you hear it at all. When it surfaces, you can still see that it is rooted in Jewish and Christian values, but it is so muted as to be almost invisible, except for when the candidates are asked specifically about it, or they believe that it is in their best interest to say a little bit about religion. I think the reason for this is that the Democrats do not want to lose their seculars, and there's a lot of them. And this is especially the case now that the nuns, N-O-N-E-S, constitute almost 25% of the overall population and a disproportionate number of Democratic voters. So if they talked about God much, this could be a problem in reaching these voters. Also, Democrats tend to be quite sensitive to the actual religious and ideological diversity of their voters and of the American people more generally, so they tend to mute any specific kind of religious talk. If you do ask Democratic candidates about faith or you probe a little bit, however, you can get answers. Hillary Clinton is occasionally quite fluent in her what you might call social justice Methodism. Tim Kaine has a moderate Catholicism going. And of course, Bernie Sanders had a kind of social justice Judaism in the background of his policies and his politics. I'll say a little more about that later. All right, so what has happened in 2016? Well, the year began looking like it would probably go according to the old script. Among the 17 GOP presidential candidates, and they all came to Indianola, I understand, they were all here, were a large number who could be described as legitimate Christian conservatives. You remember some of these guys? Rick Santorum, Mike Huckabee, Ben Carson, Ted Cruz, also Scott Walker, Marco Rubio, Bobby Jindal. All of them, I think, could be described as Christian conservatives. That's almost half. On the Democratic side, there were three candidates briefly. Jim Webb flamed out within moments, but after him, there was Hillary Clinton, Bernie Sanders, and do you remember Martin O'Malley? You put them together, you have a perfect representation of liberal, democratic, religious diversity. Hillary's Methodism, Bernie's Jewishness, and O'Malley's Catholicism, all the liberal versions thereof. All articulated social justice-y versions of the Democratic agenda with a religious background. But even by Iowa, where you all are in charge of American politics, it was clear that this year was going to be different. Jindal, Walker, Santorum, Huckabee, and eventually Carson all went down without much impact. The three finalists became Ted Cruz, John Kasich, and Donald Trump. Cruz is an extremely conservative Southern Baptist from a Pentecostal background with a very, very conservative fundamentalist father, a very conservative and very pious self-presentation, strong animus for gays, in my view, strongly opposed to abortion. Somehow, he was much cleverer in this particular campaign than the other Christian right candidates, partly due to through his strongly anti-government credentials while in the Senate, as well as a policy, fluency, and agenda that went well beyond the Christian right social conservative agenda. He ended up as the candidate of the Christian right, I would say, the main one. John Kasich, a longtime GOP politician and popular governor of Ohio, grew up Catholic and is now a conservative Anglican. He was and is much less openly pious in his talk than Ted Cruz or some of the other Christian right candidates, but he at least occasionally exuded a kind of conservative version of Catholic social teaching. One might say that he was a kind of John Paul II style compassionate conservative, at least to some extent. If the Democrats had gone with O'Malley, there would have been a kind of Pope Francis progressive Catholicism over against a Pope John Paul II conservative Catholicism. And that would have been our presidential election. That would have been very interesting to watch. And it might still be interesting to watch someday. But instead, the Democrats went with Hillary, and the Republicans went with Donald Trump from the Big Apple. And he has scrambled not just the election, but all of the old scripts. So now I turn to Donald Trump. So second movement of this talk, Donald Trump and the old-time GOP vote. Donald Trump is a candidate from a mainline Protestant background, and a very loose one at that. He attended Norman Vincent Peale's Marble Collegiate Church as a child. He now identifies as a Presbyterian. I understand he likes to collect Bibles. But let's just say that very little in his adult life leaves the impression that here we have a devout evangelical. He is a very loose, nominal, mainline Christian at best. And yet, this man knocked out at least a half dozen bona fide evangelical candidates on the GOP side, in part by winning the hearts and minds of a large number of evangelicals who voted for him in the primaries. For example, he swept the South. Closer study of the astonishing development that Donald Trump won the Republican South reveals two very important things, I think. One, when he was consolidating just enough support to get the nomination, his appeal to evangelicals was concentrated, apparently, among less frequently church-attending evangelicals and among evangelicals without a college degree. Meanwhile, he was opposed, sometimes quite actively, by many of the most visible and politically connected evangelical elite leaders. One of the most visible in this case was Russell Moore of the Southern Baptist Convention. These people are very devout and very highly educated. At the time, during the primaries, they expressed very public worry about Donald Trump. But they were not able to talk enough of their foot soldiers out of supporting him. And once he secured the nomination, they got much quieter. And so we march on to the election with Donald Trump pretty much having secured the GOP base like a normal candidate and likely to get at least 70% of white evangelicals, probably about the same as any previous Republican candidate, maybe a little bit less. We'll see. I think that this means that the almost 40-year-old alliance between the Christian conservative movement and the Republican Party lies in ruins, at least for this election. The GOP elite lost control of their own nominating process, as did the major Christian conservative allies of the GOP elite. The normal strategy failed for reasons that can be debated. I think one was because there simply were too many GOP candidates. Another was because the voters were in no mood to be told what to do by their elites. And another, I think, because both the GOP elites and the religious elites are not as powerful as they once were. Whether this is a one-time thing related to a celebrity candidate who had a TV show, or whether it portends a broader trend in the future, is not clear. When you dive a little bit deeper and ask, what does Donald Trump reveal about evangelical Christians in America? Here you get into a little more sensitive area. Everything is speculative here. I've tried a little bit of the speculation, and I'll lay a little bit of it out for you. The group of evangelicals who liked him from the beginning, when he was their choice among 17 or 12 or 6 or 8 candidates, are sometimes called the Trump-angelicals. So if you ask, who are the Trump evangelicals, and why do they support him, you can try out some ideas. Now, I myself am an evangelical Christian. I've been an evangelical Christian since 1978. This is my world. And so I'm talking about people that I know. And I'm trying to be fair. I proposed in a Religion News Service article that Donald Trump's style was not entirely unfamiliar to evangelical Christians. That there were aspects of his persona that resemble the aspects of the persona of, or personas, or a, however you would say that, of certain kinds of evangelical types that you run into. In some ways, for example, Donald Trump resembles the health and wealth or prosperity preachers, who say, if you just believe and follow me, your leader, everything will be well again. In some ways, and some of these folks are the ones who support him now on the evangelical side, in some ways he kind of reminds me of the celebrity preachers of the evangelical world. The people who have their own brands, who you know them by their name, like Rick Warren, or Bill Hybels, or somebody like that, Andy Stanley. Not that he resembles them in their character, but that they're brands, and he was already a brand. And so in a sense, he connected with that kind of brandedness. Also, evangelicals have a long, long history of being attracted to showmen and entertainers. And I think that Donald Trump was the most entertaining candidate on the Republican side. He was a showman, especially in his most interesting moments on the campaign trail. Also, in more recent days, evangelicals have produced what you might call kind of the tough bad boy preachers. And a good example of that was a man named Mark Driscoll, if you know that name. In some ways, Donald Trump resembles the kind of hyper-masculine, authoritative bad boy preacher of the evangelical subculture. What I'm saying is, you could go to church and be an evangelical Christian and be committed to that identity, and when you encountered Donald Trump, you didn't see somebody who was entirely unfamiliar in his persona. You might watch preachers like him on TV, or support them, or even go to their churches. I think this was one point of entry for Trump with some evangelicals. Also, and I think this is easier to show, I think that Donald Trump's persona reflected a kind of a masculine, authoritative, or even authoritarian persona that is also a familiar trope in evangelical Christianity. The idea is that here we have a man who stands up to political correctness. Here we have a man who is a real leader, not afraid of the nattering media people, not afraid of the women who are telling him what he's allowed to say, not afraid to take charge, not afraid to be tough, masterful, authoritative. I think this speaks into our cultural moment. There are many, many evangelical preachers who have that kind of persona and who teach male authority in the context in which male authority has been rejected in an egalitarian society. I think we're in a moment of confusion, great confusion and conflict over the meanings of gender, of power, of masculinity and femininity, and simmering frustration on the part of some men over the limits and rules on their behavior. There's some very interesting findings leaking support for Donald Trump with concern over the purported feminization of American society. There's a correlation. If you answer yes to the question that America has become too feminine and soft, then you're more likely to support Donald Trump. Third, I think Donald Trump reflects white working class anger and fear, and it's important to remember that many of the white working class are evangelicals. Donald Trump exudes a kind of working class vibe, even though he is wealthy. And he has been very white in his language and stated concerns. Here, I don't need to go through all the different things that you've said that have offended people of color, people of other races. I think that on the one hand, there are many white Americans who feel fearful and nostalgic that they are losing their country to racial minorities, including immigrants and people of other religions. But also, and so that's one piece, I think Robbie Jones, my friend who wrote a book called The End of White Christian America, is correct that a politics of nostalgia and fear is motivating a lot of white Christian voters this year. A sense of loss, a sense of a world gone away, never to come back. But still, we must not underestimate the economic troubles and the class dimensions of Mr. Trump's successful candidacy. He has spoken to many, many white working class and ex-working class people whose jobs have disappeared entirely, and along with it, their hope. He promised what others were not promising. He promised to fight for factory towns and everyday workers. He spoke to many with his message of economic populism and economic nationalism. The fact that those in the professional class, who are your commentators and media people and so on, found this incomprehensible message speaks to their privileges and their distance from the concerns of many people who are not so fortunate. I would also say on the Christian side that Trump has played a kind of a I will protect you card in relation to Christians. He has said, he's basically communicated something like this: you know, I may not be all that into the Christianity stuff, but I am Christian, and this is a Christian country, and I'm going to be sure that we restore kind of some more Christian hegemony, Christian dominance. We're going to be saying Merry Christmas in the stores, not Happy Holidays. We're going to give protection for Christians and their religious liberty. And the idea is that, hey, I will defend you. And for many people, that resonates. So, I mean, I do have concerns, and I'm going to say a little bit more, about the way that racial fears and antagonisms have played a role in Mr. Trump's campaign and in his candidacy. And here, I'll tell you a little bit about a story. In April and May, as it looked like he was going to win the nomination, a group of evangelical Christians on the progressive side wrote a statement in which we expressed concerns about the way that Donald Trump was playing with race. And this group included a lot of people of color, Latino, African-American, and some white drafters, and I was in that group. And as we were talking about what to say, a debate erupted over whether the problem was Donald Trump, or whether the problem was decades of white politicians, especially in the Republican Party, playing the race card. That in a sense that Donald Trump may simply have reaped and extended what was already out there. So do you write a statement condemning the use of race by Republican politicians for 40 years? Or do you write a statement primarily about what Donald Trump had done during his campaign? I mean, do you think about Richard Nixon's Southern strategy in the 1960s? A strategy that has never really gone away. It's an attempt to bring white voters to the GOP for life by playing on racial fears, often tied to law and order, by suggesting that the civil rights movement was really a movement of disorder and chaos, and that if you elected Republicans, there would be a war on crime, and we'd get things back under control again. This kind of move was made by Republican politicians for many, many elections. And in a sense, Donald Trump is just continuing what had already been done. I think this was the kind of thing that some of the elite white evangelicals were concerned about, both conservative and progressive. Because they believe, as I believe, that it is fundamentally immoral to play racial politics, and that Christians should know better than to allow any kind of subtle or direct appeal to race or xenophobia to make its way into American politics. And Christians, at least, should not be supportive of that. And so people like Russell Moore, a leader of the Southern Baptist Convention, which has sought desperately to purge itself of its racist past, was very sensitive to the race dimension of this campaign and worked against it. But my read is that you might say that white evangelical leaders missed the opportunity to protest earlier when these strategies were being first initiated. And so now it's probably too late. So, in the end, Trump, though he does not appeal to a lot of Republican voters, is the candidate and will probably pretty much get the Republican voting constituency that Republicans usually get. Now let me say a word on the Democratic side, where I will close. I think the Democratic reticence to speak about their underlying religious roots of their vision is bad for the Democrats, bad for America, and symptomatic of a broader liberal religious malaise. Everyone knows that mainline Protestantism is fading fast by every indicator. Allegiance, membership, bodies in the pews, size and influence of denominational establishments. This once dominant sector of American religion has been eclipsed by evangelical Christianity for 3 decades. It's about half as many mainline Christians as there are evangelicals in the U.S. It's also true, though less well known, that white Catholicism is also fading. Catholic numbers hold steady in the U.S. almost entirely due to Hispanic immigration and native-born growth, Latinos who are in the U.S. One of the single most interesting indicators of mainline Protestant decline is the fact that the Supreme Court has not had a single Protestant on it for several years. It's entirely Catholic and Jewish in its makeup. I think all of this is connected somehow to the very quiet, very implicit religiosity expressed by Democratic candidates. Isn't this symptomatic of broader tendencies in mainline Protestantism, and for that matter, in liberal Judaism? These began as deeply devout religious movements or tradition, Calvinism, Methodism, various kinds of Baptists, and so on. I know I'm at a Methodist school, so I'm going to pick on the Methodists for just a minute. John Wesley was a passionate evangelical Christian. His social justice commitments flowed out of his evangelical piety. But now, all these years later, that passionate missionary spirit, that passionate evangelistic spirit, that passionate moral perfectionism, I mean, the goal was to become morally perfect, that's all. All of that has narrowed down for a lot of Methodists to a social justice vision and not much else. This is my claim anyway. How many people today would describe United Methodists as passionate moral perfectionists, passionate evangelists, passionate missionaries, passionate about their personal piety? Yes, there are some, but over the generations, and not just for Methodists, I'm picking them because I'm here, it seems the passion has leached out of most branches of mainline Protestantism. The one thing that remains is a social justice vision, sometimes pursued very passionately. But do you really need Bible, religion, and church to have a social justice vision? It's not uncommon in my experience to see a generational transition where grandparents were passionate church-going Methodists or whatever. Parents are less passionate, but they still go to church some of the time. And the kids are not church-going, but may have retained some of the justice commitments if you can get them off their iPhones. So people, you know, people sleep in on Sunday, read the New York Times, give to Amnesty International, but don't go to church anymore. The same thing is very broadly true among progressive Jews and sometimes progressive Catholics. I've seen this. I was involved in the torture fight after 9/11, and the issue was whether the U.S. would torture, and the people who I ended up working along on the activism to prevent torture, a lot of these folks were human rights activists who came out of religious backgrounds. But they stopped going to church or synagogue or whatever. What they were really into was human rights. And I think inextricably related to this is the fact that the most passionate Christians visible on the American scene in public life are right-wingers now. People like Franklin Grant, who's a mere shadow of his dad. Or Ted Cruz, with all of his religious talk. Or before then, Jerry Falwell, or James Dobson. And you know, for people who don't like their politics, you can see how a kind of an anti-fundamentalist allergy drives people out of a desire to have any kind of religious identity at all. It helps to create a situation where the only religion, only explicit religion that you find in the public square is found among right-wing people, whose moral commitments are obnoxious to people who are not conservative. This is how you get a public square that so often looks like passionate Christian right-wingers facing off against liberal human rights activists or something, whose faith, if it exists, is very veiled or very thin or was left behind a long time ago. So imagine that you are an independent voter. You are a person of serious devout faith, Catholic or Protestant, or Jewish. What do you do? How do you vote? Who do you listen to? My own wife is an example. She's a conservative Catholic. She wants a candidate who really deeply believes in God and who will both talk and live his or her faith. So when she looks at Democratic candidates, she doesn't see much that she's looking for. And they also seem to ratify a total personal freedom agenda without many moral limits, so she's not too attracted to that. But the GOP gives you either the kind of treckly Christian right candidates like Ted Cruz, or the country club candidates like Mitt Romney, or Donald Trump. The result for her is political homelessness. She has no home to live. Without a vision, the people perish. Without a clearly articulated religio-moral vision, the Democrats concede that entire ground to the Republicans, and the mainliners cede that entire ground to the evangelicals. There are deep resources in the Protestant religious and ethical traditions that can and should be drawn on, from way back to the Reformation, the Luther, Calvin, Wesley, the Anabaptists, moved forward to the social gospel tradition, Martin Luther King and the civil rights tradition, the mainline social teaching tradition, the Catholic social teaching tradition. There are, especially on the Protestant side I'm talking about now, fascinating, morally rich voices worth drawing on. I teach my students to study William Wilberforce, the evangelical Anglican who led the abolitionist movement in England. There was Charles Finney, there was John Wesley, and many others. There's a desperate need to reclaim these kinds of voices and move them meaningfully into public life. But I think that if you want a voice that is more clearly visible today, that does not need to be reclaimed, is already doing meaningful public ethical work right now, the best place to look appears to be in the Catholic social teaching tradition. And I am especially attracted to the recent expression of that in Pope Francis. So let me close with some words about Catholic social teaching in Pope Francis. This may surprise you. I left Catholicism behind when I was confirmed at the age of 14. I grew up Catholic. I told my mom I would go until confirmation and not a day longer. And that was the best deal she could get, so that's what we did. Of course, at the time, back in the day, I had no idea of the richness of the tradition that I was abandoning. But that was before John Paul II, and before Francis, and before post-Vatican II Catholicism had found a voice that could both retain its sturdy tradition and speak to the modern moment. I see modern Catholicism, 2016 Catholicism, as a profound combination of ancient roots, plus the decisive turn to Catholic social teaching engaging the modern world that began in the early 20th century. And now, the influence of dynamic popes such as John the 23rd, John Paul II, and now Pope Francis. I think the most important religious intersection with U.S. politics was when Pope Francis visited. He offered a more global South, more economic justice, more ecological concern kind of vision than Pope John Paul II did. The latter was shaped more by the events of Europe in the 20th century, with its massive outpouring of state-sponsored killing. But whoever the Pope happens to be at any given moment, he operates within the broad and productive constraints of the Catholic social teaching tradition, with its Christocentric vision of human life, its emphasis on universal human flourishing, the sacredness of life, and a comprehensive body of teaching related to all kinds of moral dilemmas and character concerns of the human person and human community. At its best, this tradition can push for the flourishing of all people. It can transcend nationalism. It can bust out of our political left-right binaries. It can maintain political independence and a critical posture toward all parties, and pursue both and rather than either-or thinking. Catholic social teaching at its best emphasizes both personal responsibility and a strong social safety net, both local and national responsibility to address problems, both personal morality and social justice, both compassion and personal responsibility, both piety and actions in this world, both temporality and eternity, both abortion and poverty, and so on, both ecology and economic justice, ultimately both love of God and love of neighbor. No tradition is perfect. This one certainly has its blind spots, but something like this tradition needs to be brought to bear on U.S. public life in this election season. We need it to be powerful enough to resist dangerous ideologies and the passions of the moment, We need a transcendent reference point to engage the political arena at all times, and especially when fear, ideology, and tribalism threaten to get the better of us. I wish I could say that my own tribe of evangelical Protestants were offering a significant vision like this. I wish that we were speaking into this particular moment in American public life with a vision of rich and transcendent power. I don't see it. Our tradition right now, the evangelical Protestant tradition, is too weak. The movement is too tied to nostalgia politics. The leadership cadre is too white and tied to the Republican Party. It's not sufficiently independent. This is one of the great failings of a people that I have long identified with and sought to serve. I am hoping for the emergence of a self-consciously distinctive progressive evangelicalism, or even a post-evangelicalism that could take us in some more promising directions. So here we are, America 2016, as deeply divided as ever, coarser and more violent in our public life and rhetoric, a wounded people offering up and considering highly damaged candidates. I believe in the greatness of our democratic system. I am hoping we can move on from this election and do better next time with no permanent damage to the Republic. We shall see. Thank you very much for your kind attention to my lecture.
We have a few minutes for questions. As is the tradition here, we ask that our first question or two come from students.
Will you recognize the hands, Mark, so I don't have to do that? That one is.
Okay, cool. So I was going to ask, you talked a little bit about religious freedom, and you mentioned your book, Changing Our Minds. I was wondering if you could talk a little bit about the religious right and the prevalence of peripheral laws starting to be enacted, and then also a little bit about your views on the LGBT community and how they changed and that relationship with politics.
One of the things I have liked about the Trump canvassing is that he is not an anti-gay activist. I read him as relatively indifferent on those questions. And so, at least to some extent, LGBT people have not been placed on the altar of our politics this year in the same way that it sometimes happened in the past. My heart has been broken for the suffering of LGBT people through a lot of experiences, including members of my family, students, fellow church members, and I have moved into a place of solidarity with LGBT people to the best that I am able. And this was articulated in my book in 2014. This is yet another example of a massive social change that many people are having trouble adjusting to. I think that, and I've written some about the religious liberty kind of RFRA movement to try to deal with that. Some of these measures, I think, are just, they go way too far and they're blatantly discriminatory. And I was glad when my governor, a conservative Baptist, who I happen to know in Georgia, decided to veto such a law when it was passed in our state. I think that this is a social change that is going to be gradually assimilated over the next 15 or 20 years, and people will come to accept that there is a reality of gender identity and sexual orientation difference, and that people need to be respected for who they are and not discriminated against. And so that's where I am on it. I think it has affected our politics a little less this year than it might have if the Republicans had picked a different candidate. And so in a sense, some of the people who are most concerned about Donald Trump on the Republican side are those who are fully aware that their agenda on that issue is not going to make a lot of progress in this election. And so so I think that is an interesting dynamic in this election. Thanks.
Hi.
Um,
So you said in the last question. Okay.
Hi, you said in the last question that Trump wasn't like anti-gay. Do you have any comments about his running mate, Mike Pence, and how that might...
Yeah, I think that Mike Pence is a very traditional Midwestern conservative Republican. And that the Republicans, especially if they lose this time, may well pick a very traditional Midwestern conservative Republican in 2020. Because he speaks to the concerns of a lot of people. I do think that the head of the ticket is always far more important in terms of what the main policy agendas are going to be. But yeah, so Pence and Trump are very, very different in every way. It's been interesting to see them try to work together.
Okay.
So many hands, so little time.
You talked a little bit about evangelicals supporting Trump and seeing similarities in preachers and that sort of thing. But a thing you didn't address very much was the idea of like evangelical patriotism, like putting the flag up almost as an idol in the church. I am an evangelical, so I have seen the American flag right next to the cross my entire life.
Right.
So does that? Do you think that white nationalism kind of stems from that identity in you?
That one goes back to the 60s. I think one of the best ways to interpret our politics is to pick a year like 1968 and then look at the social changes that were sweeping the country at that time. Those who were for the social changes and those who were against them. And I should have said, I'm glad you raised it, and I did this in a talk yesterday in Indianapolis, that take the anti-Vietnam movement in 1968. So, what was happening in the 60s for the first time, I think, in memory, was a major group of people not just questioning a particular war, but questioning the goodness of America. Questioning whether America was on the good side of history, and whether, therefore, the flag was a symbol of good, always. Or whether it was at least an ambivalent symbol. And so, since that period, in general, the Republican side has strongly emphasized patriotism, the flag, you know, national identity, national loyalty. And the Democratic side has had a mix of people who do just the same, and people who are a little more kind of edgy, you know, America, you know, and all the problems of American history and that kind of thing. And so, yes, to the extent that Mr. Trump has appealed to strong national loyalty and pride and patriotism that connects with, like you said, what most evangelical Christians, in fact, people in most churches see every Sunday, the flag, America, up there at the front of the church. And strongly emphasized in many Christian schools and many Christian families, loyalty to the nation. So, yeah. It's been, I think it was interesting, at the Democratic Convention, the Democrats tried very, very hard not to be out-patriotized by the Republicans. You know, the flags were everywhere and, you know, all of that, pro-military, pro-America, and all of that. Because the Democrats learned a long time ago that if you run on a kind of an anti-America platform, you're doomed, right? So that's not what they're trying to project. But yes, he's very strong on that. And a lot of evangelicals resonate.
So you mentioned a bit about Bernie Sanders and where his faith or lack thereof had to do with his white challenges. Hoping that you could articulate that a bit more.
Yeah. You know, there has never been a Jewish president. There has, to my knowledge, only been one Jewish vice presidential candidate, right? Bill Lieberman. And it would be It would be quite something in American history for us to have a Jewish president. It would be another major development, another major revolution in our history. That may be one reason why he didn't lead with his Jewish identity. Now, when he was accused of being secular, he denied it. He said that he was Jewish, and he was proudly Jewish, and his faith did affect his way of looking at the world. And there is a long, long tradition of kind of a you know, social justice Judaism. It's just everywhere. Liberal Judaism, progressive Judaism has always had these social justice commitments. So that had some interesting possibilities if we had gone further and we had heard more about that. But in some ways, those commitments are not that different from Hillary's social justice Methodism. It's, what they share in common is an emphasis on concern for the poor, concern for the least of these, inclusive politics, you know, economic leveling, all those kinds of things that you tend to hear on the Democratic side. So I think it's fair to say that in general, liberal democratic politics is inflected by a kind of a social justice liberal religion, whether it comes out of Catholicism, Protestantism, or Judaism. Yeah. Good questions. There were all these hands and they all went away.
So I just had a question. It seems to me that the evangelical movement, whether they mean to or not, continues to either to try to get the most conservative nominee, even if it means a loss. Like we talked about earlier, how the Kasich path to victory would have been a lot easier than the Cruz path to victory. And so I was wondering if you think that that, or how soon that's going to change, where they will choose the person who's more likely to win, but is maybe not as conservative?
That's a great question. I think that there is always a tendency towards purism and zealotry in politics and in religion, and especially in religious politics. Right? So you put them together, you know, it's like you can't compromise on anything. So like, let's say you believe that there should be no abortion in America, zero. But you know from polling that if you put forward a candidate who believes in zero access to abortion, they'll never win. But you're sitting there thinking, if I compromise on that, I'm allowing babies to be murdered. I can't allow babies to be murdered at all. So therefore, I'm going to go with a candidate who will not allow babies to be murdered, even though such a candidate will never be elected. So here you're dealing with the question of whether you can ever compromise, you know, whether to get 78% of what you want is better than getting 0% of what you want because you get that temporary victory and it feels good, but that person loses. I know that the Democrats have struggled with that sometimes too. You know, you get the purest liberal candidate who will always lose, or you get the purest conservative candidate who will always lose. And so generally, the parties usually find somebody who is at least center right or center left with a chance. But I think in some ways, the conservative Christians are in a spiral that goes like this. We don't like how our country is going, we must protest. With each new thing we don't like, we must protest harder. We must support candidates who will fight all of this. We keep supporting candidates who can't win, now we're even more concerned, so we must fight harder. And now we're going to get somebody who's even more conservative, and they're going to lose again, so we must fight harder. And meanwhile, the more extremist we sound, the less we appeal to the like centrist people. And so the more people are turned off by us, and so then we interpret that as religious persecution. Everybody hates us because we're following Jesus so faithfully. So now we just need to follow Jesus more faithfully so everybody will hate us more. And so then we can be even less effective. And I think that they're in that kind of spiral. I just think that's a death spiral. And I hope that they're working through it.
I guess my question is more that, like, I know that it happens on the Democratic side, but there's such a large voting block that it affects everyone. Like, as a more moderate Republican, that affects, you know, and I know there's a lot of women citizens too that feel the same way.
So. Right. I know that there are a lot of independents and somewhat conservative Democrats, given the flaws of Hillary Clinton's candidacy, who would have voted for John Kasich. I know this for a fact. I would have voted for John Kasich. The Republicans missed a bet. They had an opportunity. There he was. But instead of the purist Cruz, they got Trump. which is, I mean, the irony of American politics is just amazing. Wow.
Time for one more.
When you were talking about the sort of colorless, passionless state that the liberal Protestants find themselves in, I remember that I read an article in Harper's a few months ago saying, where are the Christian intellectuals? Where is Niebuhr, nowadays? The public intellectuals. We'll speak to the public. And I've been stewing about it because it seems like part of the dilemma of progressive religious people is that we don't want to be over against. You know, in a very tribal society, we don't want to create another division. And I'm United Church of Christ, so you can think Methodists are with me, you know. and I grew up understanding that to be faithful was to be self-critical, you know, and not to call out the speck in my neighbor's eye when I had a log in my eye. And, you know, all those things sort of lead to a self-silencing. And I would like to hear more about how we can get around that.
What a great question. I am doing a major research project right now on Walter Rauschenbusch, the social gospel leader of the early 20th century. And one of the things I'm concluding is that Rauschenbusch started the trajectory that I just lamented, because he so emphasized that the mission of the church is social justice and social transformation, the social gospel, that one of the implications was a couple of generations down the line, you don't really need the church, you just need the activism. And I don't think he intended that at all, but that's been kind of a trajectory. But speaking of voice, I mean, the theologian and ethicist who I studied most closely in graduate school was Reinhold Niebuhr. And I love Niebuhr's forceful engagement in public life. And for a period from, you know, like the early 20th century until the 60s, there were these really forceful Protestant intellectuals who were heard in American public life. It wasn't just Niebuhr, it was a lot of others too. And they wrote, not just in like the Christian journals, but in like Time magazine and stuff like that. And I always modeled myself after them. I wanted to be like that. And they were not afraid to take stands. And they wrote with a kind of a forceful vocabulary, and they offended people all the time. And they made a contribution. They were heard. They could not be missed. They were energetic and articulate, and they were everywhere. I think that you're right to identify we don't want to seem judgmental about anything or anybody, and we don't want to offend, and we don't want to create conflict. But after a while, I think that strategy fails also. Why bother? What's the appeal? If you just want to be a really nice, vaguely liberal person, why go to church? You can be a really nice, vaguely liberal person and get to sleep in on Sunday. And that's kind of nice, because sleep is nice. We're all tired, right? So I'm still an evangelical in the sense that I think that religion has to have some teeth to it. Has to have some vitality, passion, demand, energy. You have to be different and better because you're involved in it. It makes you relate to people differently. It makes you real soul and light. You know, you're really different. And so I'm actually seeing in the next generation, 35 and younger, a lot of post-mainline and post-evangelical people finding each other. Like, those evangelicals who were like, hey, that's for the birds, if that's what they're about, forget it. And the mainliners who were like, I want some passion with my religion. I want some vitality. And they're finding each other in a kind of a convergence, post-mainline, post-evangelical, something new. And that's the kind of event I was at yesterday in Indianapolis. And I hope that schools like Simpson can be incubators of these kinds of conversations, and people can find each other. Because the old models are not working very well. It's one reason why Catholicism is doing so well in the American public square, because the Protestant versions are so weak and messed up. But I'm not prepared to give up on you know, this great religious tradition, and I think some new voices are emerging and finding each other that provide some hope for the future.
Quick reminder, we do have a table outside for signing books, so please stop by if you'd like, and join me in thanking Dr. Fitch.